of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up. Shining in
the sun.
Pour out your power and love.
Jesus.
Amen. Are you happy to be in the house of God this afternoon? Amen. Amen.
First and foremost, I just want to apologize. I'm not wearing a tie. I completely slipped my my mind, so I do apologize. But I have a blazer. So you forgive me for that. Sometimes, you know, you just get so caught up with what you're going to preach, and then you just kind of forget some of the simple things. Amen. So, saints, I just wanted to mention to you all, and if you all don't know, real quick, I wanted to share with you, I don't know if you all are aware about the podcast that we've been doing lately. It's called 10,000 Worlds. I'm currently about on episode 9, and what a podcast is, if you don't know, it's kind of like a radio program, but it's pre-recorded, and it goes directly to your phone, to your tablet, or to your computer, wherever you listen. And what the purpose of the podcast that we're trying to do is we're trying to interview, saints, getting their testimonies of what God's doing in their lives, trying to target our young people, even trying to get young people involved to where they can share what God is doing in their lives. And last episode that we had Brother Ryan and Sister Gabby's testimony. And so it was wonderful to sit there in their living room with them and just them share about their battle with depression and their battle with suicide and just things like that they went through. And so we have a couple of things more lined up with it. So if you don't know how to deal or work with the podcast, I know not everybody knows how to tune in and listen to it. You can get with me, and I can share that with you. So I think that'll be a blessing. And you just pray for that, because I want us to hear what God is doing in our day amongst people. Amen. We got so many Christians and so many believers around the world that God is doing great things among, and we have no idea what God's doing. Amen. So that, and I think that'll be an encouragement to each and every one of us. You know, it was great to hear what God did 40, 50 years ago. That's wonderful. We still need those things. Amen. But what is God doing now? Amen. What is God doing in your life? Because He's still the same yesterday, Amen. Today, and forever. Amen. So you pray for us as we do in this endeavor. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Let's just bow our heads tonight. Our gracious Lord, as we come before you right now, Father God, we want to just commit ourselves into your hands, Lord, and asking you, dear Lord Jesus, that you would just come on the scene this evening, Lord God. Father God, we've done what we could, Lord, as a minister, Lord God. We've studied, we've prayed, we've committed ourselves to you, Lord. But now, Heavenly Father, you have to take the rest, Lord God Almighty. Now I give you the reins, Lord Jesus, and you do as you wish, Father God, through your word, Lord. Speak to our hearts this evening, Lord God. Let us, Father God, change from the inside out, Lord God. Not from the outside in, Lord, but from the inside out, Lord God. And let us consider the things, Father God, these things, Father God, for there's certainly, Father God, you care about those things. And now the question is, do we care, Lord? So I pray, Father God, that you'd help us this evening. Bless Brother Dale. Bless Sister Peggy, Lord. Those that are out right now, Lord, that are sick, may you be with them, Lord God. Strengthen their bodies, Father, right now, Lord. And comfort them, Lord. Bring them peace right now and bring them comfort, Lord, I pray. Father God, I pray this evening also, Lord, for the Benton family, Lord God, there in Tennessee, yeah, Brother Jackie's wife, Lord, the passing away of his wife, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would just bring comfort to the family as they're having the funeral arrangements now, and I think even a service this evening in memorial of her. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would just remember the family, be with them, comfort them, be with Brother Jackie, Lord, for he's up in age as well, Lord. And may you just be with him during this time, Lord God. May you just bless them now. Bless our time now. We commit ourselves into your hands now. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Amen. If you want to turn with me, and the brothers can pull it up, in 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 through 17. The Bible says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Amen. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Amen. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Amen. And then if we want to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 through 5, the Bible says here, moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink. Notice they all partook of this. For they drank of the spiritual rock, of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Amen. If I want to give this a title tonight, I just want to call it A Neglected Thirst. A Neglected Thirst. Amen. You may be seated this evening. Praise the Lord, saints. Brother Joe, or whoever's in the back, can you cue up that's, I want you all to listen to this prayer that Brother Branham made in this message. It was at the end of this message, but the message entitled Corinthians, Book of Corrections. I just want you to pay attention, and I want you to consider this, and just listen here for just a moment. I think if you wanna forward it to timestamp 104. An hour and 4 minutes. And let's see, hour and 4 minutes and 29 seconds. That's fine. Just leave it there.
Sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Paul was warning his church of this, the Corinthian church, which it was all mixed up in all kinds of fantastic. I'm warning you, friends. Remember, I'll have to answer for you at the day of judgment, and your blood won't be upon me. No matter how loyal you are to anything else, be loyal to Christ. Remember that as we pray. Blessed Heavenly Father, in this present state we come now, I am confessing all of our wrongs. Oh, be thou merciful, merciful God. And we pray that you will look down into our hearts. And in this hour, while we're waiting with our heads bowed to the dust, look into the heart of the old man, into the heart of the elderly men, into the heart of the middle aged and the young, even the little children. And may we examine ourselves. We are coming into that Holy Week that we celebrate as Good Friday and Easter, the resurrection. Though this year we might have been loyal to church, though we might have taken communion, though we might have shouted, we might have done many things, but oh God, look down into my heart. I talk for myself. Look into my heart, into the heart of this people here this morning, and examine us, Lord. If there be something that takes the place of Christ, oh God, take it away. If it's laziness, it's insufficiency. If it's whatever it might be, I don't know, but God, take it from us. Oh, we don't want to be overthrown right here at the time of the battle. Overthrown by God and be an enemy to Him. Oh, God, look into our hearts. Examine us by Thy Holy Spirit. And let us see this morning if there's any evil thing in us. If there is, take it away, Father. We now lay it on the altar to walk away and leave it there. If it's idleness, if it's temper, if it's indifference, if it's neglecting, if it's whatever it may be, if it's hatred, if it's malice, if it's strife, if it's whatever it may be, oh God, take it from us today. And at this coming revival, may we be just so full of Your charm, Lord, until many will come in and be saved. The little community here where we've tried so hard, the first revival now in 10 years that have helped. Now I pray that You'll give us that real spirit in our heart, and may it anchor there for eternity. Grant it, Lord. Make us to examine ourselves. We married people, by the way we treat our wives, how true we are, or how true our wives is to us. And may we just get in our hearts this morning how we'd think of something like that happening in our home. And then may we turn our affections towards You and say, oh God, be merciful to me. Oh, if the wife would just about every once a month just come by and put her hand on yours and say, dear, I love you, and walk on. Oh, how it would seem she was neglecting me. How it would seem that something was wrong. And God, when maybe once a month or once when we go to church, we offer a little prayer. Oh, You want our love, our communion all the time, that our thoughts and our intents of our heart will be stayed on Thee. Grant it, Lord. Oh, keep our hearts so set on Thee that the things of the world will become blind and so indifferent. Grant it, Lord. Hear us now and bless us in the further part of these services. We ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I thought that prayer was such a sincere prayer. And I believe that every true Christian, amen, that would be the prayer of every true Christian. Amen. To God, amen, to change our hearts, amen, and to look deep down in what it is, amen, that is causing us and hindering our walk with God, amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. So I want us to, in light of that, saints, I just want us to read 2 Timothy chapter 3 again, in verse 16. The Bible says here, as we read, but I'm going to read it from the God's Word translation. And it says here, every scripture passage is inspired by God. All of them are useful for teaching, pointing out errors, correcting people, and training them for a life that has God's approval. Amen. I thoroughly believe, saints, that the Word of God, amen, every passage of the Bible, amen, wasn't just put there just to be put there. There's a purpose behind it. Amen. And that's the reason, saints, why we as ministers, amen, we need to consider about preaching the whole counsel of God. Amen. Not just take one little part because we feel comfortable with just this one part. Amen. But you see, saints, that we have needs in our congregations. We have needs within our families. We have needs that need to be addressed. And yet sometimes we neglect as ministers to find the mind of God. To look and say, Lord, where is it that the people need? What is it that the people want? What is it that the people, what current needs do they have? And yet we give them something else. And they're bleeding and they're hurting. And we give something else. Amen. Praise the Lord.
We shouldn't be picky with the Word of God. You shouldn't say, well, I'm going to take this, but not take this. No, we take the whole Word of God. Amen. Because it's the Word of God. It's profitable. Every scripture passage is inspired by God. All of them are useful for teaching, pointing out errors, correcting people. Oh, well, we shouldn't correct people. I beg your pardon. The Word of God says different. Amen. The Word of God says that we need to correct people. Amen. Because if we don't correct your child, saints, they'll run rampant. Amen. Praise the Lord. And training them for a life that has God's approval. Amen. Do you want your life to have God's approval? I want God to look down at me and smile and say, oh son, you're doing good. And say, daughter, you're doing good. You're trying to do everything you can with what you've got, amen, to live for me, amen? I want that. So it's absolutely vital, saints, that we, amen, as ministers, amen, we reach out, amen, and we speak to the families, amen. We reach out to the children, we reach out to the older ones, we reach out to each and every one, because we are all in different levels. And we all have different needs in our heart. Amen. My daughter Bella, she's almost 13 years old. She has certain needs that I don't have. Amen. She's at an age, amen, that's critical. And if I'm not there to minister to those needs, I'm doing her a disservice as a parent. You see? At that moment, amen, that's wonderful. And this is no slam against the minister here. But at that moment, what will Daniel 70 weeks do me when they're hurting? No disrespect, brother Wade, but at that moment, what will that do good to me? When they're hurting, when something's going wrong, amen. You need, amen, to go in and look deeper into the root cause of things. And I'm afraid, saints, that a lot of times, amen, we fail to do that, and we wonder why our church goes a certain direction. We wonder why our families go a certain direction. Why the church, amen, in the whole is not prospering in the Word of God. Because we neglect, amen. I'm neglecting. That's why I titled this A Neglected Thirst. I neglect to address those needs, amen, that my family may have. Sure, I may be a provider. Sure, I provide food for them. Sure, I put food on the table, but that's not enough. You as a parent, amen, if you don't spend time with your children, if you don't look and see that they need you. They don't need your money. They don't need the food. They need those things, but what they really crave and want is you. I'm speaking to the parents now. And most of us here probably have had children. They want is you. I heard a story one time of somebody that was in a grocery store, and he had his little 3-year-old boy son with him, and he was walking in the grocery store with him, and he said, and a man stopped him, and he said, sir, is that your son? And he said, yes, sir. He told him, you know what? Love that boy. You know what? Love, you know, I love that boy. He said, you know how you spell love? T-I-M-E. Think about that. Time. And if we don't spend time with our children, if we neglect, amen, to look at the things that really matter, amen, because we're so busy, caught up with everything else, even if it's for the good, God has given us people directly under our roof, amen, that we need to spend time with and to nurture and to care for. Amen. You'll be responsible, and you're the one who's to answer for that. Amen. Later on here, we're going to read a story, amen, that's of somebody that exact same thing happened to in the Bible. Amen. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul's here, he's speaking to Gentiles. Amen. And he says, moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers, amen, were under the cloud. Amen. All the Israelites back then, they went under the cloud. They came out of Egypt, and I'm just going to try to move as quick as possible. They came out of Egypt. They were baptized. They crossed over the Red Sea. They did all these things under Moses. They all partook of it.
Amen.
And yet, only two were made it to the Promised Land.
Yep, that's
right. Out of all those people, only two of them made it to the Promised Land. Yet they had the message of the hour. You see, that was the message of the hour. They were all baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, you know. They all had these things. Amen. But only two were able to make it. Amen. See, you could be here and you can have all the mysteries and you can have all the doctrine and you can have everything down to the T. But if you don't have love, Paul said, you're nothing. You can have every date and you can have everything, amen, down to the T. But if you don't have love in your heart for one another, you're nothing. Paul said you're only a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. And if you can't really, truly from your heart say, I love you, brother. Forgive me, brother. Forgive me, sister. Forgive me. And you know that you need to. Something's wrong with you. I don't think the love of God is dwelling there. And you know what the love of God is? When you're born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Ghost has come upon your soul. That means that you have full eternal life in your soul. It means that you should have all of God in you, including love. And God is love, the Bible says. God is truth. God is peace. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You should have all these things. And if that love is not being expressed, as we'll read here in just a moment, that agape love, that love of God, then something's wrong. You need to reconsider. Am I really born again? Do I really? I'm not trying to bring doubt, saints. I'm trying to encourage you. Because some of us, we just walk in this life, maybe thinking that we have something when in reality we may not. Just because you go to this church doesn't mean that you're born again. Just because you can explain Daniel's 70 weeks and the seals and all the mysteries down to the T doesn't mean that you're born again. You can have it all up here and not have God, and you miss God by 10,000 miles. When you don't know how to act around one another, you disrespect one another, you make fun of people even from the pulpit, calling people names when they disagree with you. That's wrong. That's not the love of God. And did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ, but with many of them. See, with many of them, God was not well pleased. And they were all going through these motions. They were all doing everything that Moses told them to do, and they were obeying the message. And God was not well pleased with all of them. Now, verse 6 of that same, of 1 Corinthians chapter 10 says, now these things were our examples to the intent, for the purpose that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. That's why these things were written in the Word, amen. Not just for historical facts and figures, amen, but they were written for us, for our example, so that we can look and say, wow, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be like that. I don't want to make that decision and then have to pay for it later. Saints, God cares about you. God cares about your soul, whether you're old, whether you're young, whether you're middle-aged. It doesn't matter. God is concerned about your life. God is concerned where you are right now.
Amen.
Don't think that God is not. He is. And He loves you. And He has a specific word to minister to your specific need at this very moment, no matter what age you are. Praise the Lord. If we skip down to verse 11, Paul says here, now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition. You see the purpose why those things were written? For our admonition, for us to look and say, wow, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be like that.
Amen.
Amen. upon whom the ends of the world come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. Sometimes we think that we feel such a security on us because we come to this church and we throw our Lula security blanket on us. Because Brother Dale, he preaches the word, and Brother Wade preaches the word, and the minister here preaches the word. Oh no, man, I'm so comfortable. I know Daniel 70 weeks. I got it down to the T, and you don't know how to love your brother? That security blanket is not doing you any good. You don't know how to treat each other. You don't know how to disrespect each other. Amen. I'll be the one to say, I've done that. I've been there, done that. But I want to change.
Amen.
I want to change. I want saints. And if the change is going to happen with me so that the rest of the church can change, amen, then so be it. I want that.
Amen.
I want to get out of here.
Amen.
Amen. But because we fail sometimes to address things at the root level, amen. And we find ourselves in positions that we shouldn't be at.
That's right.
Corinthians book of correction, Brother Branham says here, every one of them went into the wilderness. Jesus said, not all that saith, Lord, Lord, will enter in, but the one that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. It isn't what you say. You could preach the gospel and still be lost.
Right.
Certainly. This is not just little kids stuff, Brother Branham says. This is absolutely, it's deep. We need the major doctrines of the Bible. We need those things. I'm not discrediting them. I'm not. That's not what I'm trying to do. We need those things. We appreciate the things that we hear in our church. But Brother Brown said here, these things, living a good Christian life, living a Christian life, and knowing how to treat one another, that's deep. And some of us, we don't know how to do that. And yet we've been in the message for 40 years. You don't know how to treat each other. I don't know. Maybe I'm overstepping my boundaries. I hope not. But I'm just trying to encourage you, saints. And Christianity is not just to be just a little light, fabulous thing like, well, I'll go over to church and I know it's my duty to go. That's not Christianity. Just because you're here and you're warming up pew, that's not Christianity. That's not. It's something that God has done. See, you can't do it. God has to do it. God has chosen you in Christ and presented you as a love gift to Christ. And if God's calling election, and if we have the opportunity to become that type of person and turn it down for little old things of the world. Brother Branham continues in that same message. But brother, it's a lot more than intellectuals. We need good teaching. Again, don't get me wrong. We need teaching. We need the fivefold ministry. But just because you can explain the things of the Bible doesn't mean you're born again. You could just have a security blanket on you. It goes to a genuine birth, not just a mental conception or an emotional work, but a birth, an experience, something that goes plumb down deep into the heart and change in the innermost. See, in that prayer that Brother Branham was talking about, constantly mentioning the heart. Lord, change my heart. Amen. Because, saints, we can have the baptism of the Holy Ghost in our soul. But we still, that's the reason why we need the stature of a perfect man. Because we still wrestle with our spirit. Amen. We still wrestle with the five senses of the spirit realm.
That's right. Amen.
Tell them to me again, by the way.
Memory, reason, conscious, affection,
and imagination. The new birth in your soul doesn't change those things. That's the reason why we need, amen, the stature of a perfect man.
Amen.
And so it's a constant battle day by day. And if we are working in the spirit, man, then it's going to manifest in the flesh, man. Amen. Jesus said, whatever's in your heart, that's what you're going to portray. Amen. Out of the abundance of the heart speaks the mouth. Don't tell me that you're a Christian. Amen. Don't tell me that you're a Christian and you're talking dirty all the time. That just tells me one thing. That's what you feed on. Don't tell me that you're a Christian and you're constantly looking at people hateful, resentful, bitter. That's what you feed on. Amen. That makes you do things that you would not have done. Otherwise, it makes you love those who are unlovable. Makes you act different than you ever thought that you would act. And when situations arise, it's your anchor. Amen. Amen. No matter what it is, in the home, in the church, no matter what situation it is, if it arises, amen. If you have that, amen, in your innermost, in your soul, amen, that expresses through the spirit, man, and out through the flesh, man, amen, that's your anchor. That's this love. Amen. That's the reason why. If you have love in your soul, which is God is love, right? The scripture says that. Then it should be reflecting, amen, showing forth through your spirit, man, and out your flesh, man. But if it's not, then what are we supposed to conclude? Think about that, saints. You could just be in a justification or sanctification estate. And you can explain all these mysteries and yet died this tonight without the baptism of the Holy Ghost in your soul.
Amen.
If we go back and read 1 Corinthians chapter, well, this is a new scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Let's read from verses 1 through 3. I want to read from the Good News Translation because it has more impact. Amen. And all of you know this scripture. I may be able to speak the languages of human beings and even of angels, but if I have no love, my speech is no more than a noisy gong or a clanging bell. I may have the gift of inspired preaching. I may have all knowledge, and understand all secrets, whether in life or in the word. I may have all the faith needed to move mountains. But if I have no love, Paul says, I am nothing. That's pretty strong. Because see, sometimes we base our life and we base our experience that we on the externals. That because we do this or we know this or we come to Lula, we've got it. That doesn't mean that. Amen. I may give away everything I have and even give up my body to be burned, but if I have no love, this does me no good. And when you go back and look at that word love there, that's the word agape. That's not a filial love that Paul was talking about. That's the love of God. So if you have no love, the love of God in you, and you can explain Daniel 70 weeks, everything. And you can explain the seven seals and you can explain everything down to the T. And there's no love in your heart. It either means one of three things. You're either in a justified state or in a sanctified state. Or you don't have anything at all. You're an unbeliever. Or you just have it up here, but it hasn't come down here. That can mean, that's the only three things that can mean.
Amen.
Think on these things, saints. Where are you? Brother Branham preached a message called, amen, thinking on your ways, you know, something on that line. As I thought on my way. Think on your life. Am I here at church just because it's a tradition? Because I'm supposed to come. Amen. Well, what is the purpose of me living a Christian life? Am I impacting other people spiritually? What are you doing that's impacting people spiritually? And sometimes we get criticized, amen, for doing something for God and doing something for God. I'll ask you, what are you doing? What are you doing for God that's impacting your children, that's impacting your husband, your wife, your pastor, your church, amen, the people out here? What do they see? Or do they see just formality and tradition? That's no different than a Catholic church. We may not have statues here, but we can make this a Catholic church. A denomination. The word can't be denominated. This message can't be denominated, but in your heart and your mind, it can be by the way you look at it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 through 11. It continues here. Love is patient. And then the Good News Translation. Love is patient. It is not jealous or conceited or proud. Love is not ill-mannered or selfish or irritable. Love does not keep a record of wrongs. Love is not happy with evil, but is happy with the truth. I want the truth. Amen. Give me. I want the truth. Let me do whatever I can to get to the truth. Amen. Love never gives up, and its faith, hope, and patience never fail. Love is eternal.
Amen. That's right.
Because it's the love of God, right? There are inspired messages, but they are temporary. There are gifts of speaking in strange tongues, but they will cease. There is knowledge, but it will pass. And skip down to verse 11. When I was a child, my speech, feelings, and thinking were all those of a child. Now that I am an adult, I have no more use for childish ways. Some of us here are adults and still act like children spiritually. I put myself in there as well. We should be eating the heavy things of God.
Amen.
And letting those heavy things of God, the strong meat, amen, changing us from the inside out. But sometimes some of us are even still questioning to this day whether you have the Holy Ghost or not. And you've been coming to this church for 40 years and you've listened to the message for 40, 50 years and you still don't know if you got the Holy Ghost. I'm challenging you, saints. It's a late hour.
Amen.
For us to just be playing church.
Right.
Amen. Right. This is maybe not what you came to hear. Amen. But it's the Word of God. Am I not preaching the Word of God?
Right.
It is the Word. You get mad at the Word. Don't get mad at me.
Right.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, I'm just going to skip down some of these things. Amen. Amen. So if your own soul hasn't been sealed by the baptism of the Holy Ghost, amen, in order to display this love, what does it matter that you know all these mysteries?
That's right.
What does it matter?
Amen.
Amen. We say phrases like people in this message. The people in this message, you know what you're doing when you do that? You're throwing seeds of dissension in people's minds. Because I believe people out there want the same heaven that you and I do. They may not be in the same place where you are. They may not be in the same spot or have the same revelation that you are, but they're striving. I would rather be at a place where it's full of love than to have no love whatsoever and yet know all these mysteries down to a T. Why do we do that?
That's not the love that Paul was talking about. We're doing the congregation a disservice. Amen. Saints, it's like Brother Branham's talked about when he talked about that eagle, the eagle's nest. Amen. And he made it, and he made it, and the eagle made it all comfortable, and all the eaglets there were all comfortable. But it came a time, saints. It came a time that they needed to go fly. They needed to go fly on their own. You need to, there has to come a point in time that you need to know these things for your own. Amen. It's not enough that the ministry knows it. Amen. You do. How are these things? You know them, and how are they impacting you? Are they changing you from the inside out? And are they causing change in other people? Affecting other people. Amen. Because sometimes, saints, we need to say these things. We need to say these things sometimes because sometimes we like our comfort zones. I didn't come here to make you comfortable tonight. I didn't come here, I'm not going to be silent, to make you comfortable. Get on that security blanket again. It's so cozy. No. The mother eagle at some point in time rips that skin off the nest and say, it's time for you all to fly. That's what I'm saying to you tonight, saints. It's time for us to fly. Amen. It's time for us to get out of here. Praise God. Little things, amen, come up, amen, and we're all childish about it. It's time for us to fly. Because, saints, you know, when it came time to rebuke bad behavior, Paul rebuked bad behavior. And he gave a reason for it. When it came time to deal with the husband and it came time to deal with the wife, Paul dealt with those things. Paul dealt with children. Dealt with the children. Paul dealt with the home life. Paul dealt with ministry. Paul dealt with all these items, amen, in the Bible. And so did Brother Branham. Praise God. Amen. And if we ministers, amen, if we choose, amen, to be silent about these things, then our silence is the bullet that's going to kill the congregation. Amen. Praise God. And sometimes we're afraid, amen, to look at these things because we don't like conflict. We don't like a conflict. We like things so easy, and we like things just a microwave fix and move on. And don't tell me that's not how things are. And you know what? That's going to cause you problems in the long run. You know what that's called? That's called sweeping things under the rug. Problems keep coming up. Same problem. Sweeping it under the rug. Before you know it, that thing is going to be piled up over here. And everything that you had under there is what's causing, and your house is going to cave in. You're tripping over the rug because you failed to deal with things at the root level. Do you want to hear about a story about somebody in the Bible that didn't deal with things in the root level and what it caused them? It's in the Bible. And there's quite a few examples in the Bible, but this one right here is the one that catches my attention more. And I want all parents to listen. Listen to this. Because this was a father. A father who neglected, amen, his family, his who was a king. We're talking about David here. He had six sons. The first six sons that he had, one of them being Absalom, he was the third one. The first one was Ammon or Mammon or something like that. I can't remember. I'll go back in here in just a moment. So you read that he had these sons in 1 Samuel chapter 3, and
He had these six sons. And then there's no mention again of these sons until Samuel chapter 13. And all this time, David was busy being a king. He was busy building the city, fighting wars, busy with the responsibilities of being a king and forgetting that he had wives and concubines and children at his house that needed him. He was busy. And sometimes saints, us as parents, we're just too busy. That's why I said earlier today, a while ago, we're just too busy to do the things, amen, to spend time with our children, to spend time with our wives, to spend time with our husbands, amen, to do those little things. You say, it doesn't matter, you know, they'll be fine. Oh, I beg your pardon. Yeah. It matters a whole lot. Some of you probably have experienced that, and you see the effects of not doing that. And you know, if you want to read soap operas or drama, just read the books of 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings. That right there is the most soap operas that you can have. You don't need Days of Our Lives. You don't need none. I don't know what soap operas are out there now, but you don't need none of these things. You just read those lives. If you want to see stories of rape and murder and deceit and all these things, you just go back and read those books. It's there. But remember what Paul said. They're there for our examples. They're there not just to inform ourselves. Amen. They're there for us to look and say, wow, I don't want that in my life. I don't want that in my life. Amen. So David's time was spread so thin. Amen. Because of his multiple wives and concubines and children. Amen. But David, even though he was a wonderful king, did what he was supposed to do and loved God. We see that he loved God. Yet he was an absent father. To all of his sons, but especially to Absalom. And sometimes we neglect. Amen. How do we balance the life work in our lives? You know, but there's got to be a balance. God gave you those children for you to just constantly be working all the time, and neglecting those children. Amen. That's a disservice to them. They need you. Amen. Because children's needs, as I said earlier, they go way beyond for you providing food at the table. they go way beyond that. Just because you provide for them food on the table or give them some money from time to time or whatever, that does not mean that they have your heart, that you have their heart. I want my children's heart. I want my daughter's heart. Amen. First of all, I want God to have their heart. Amen. But I want them to be so comfortable with me. I want them to be able to come to me whenever they have issues. Come to my wife whenever they have. The first people they come to is to come to us. They can be so comfortable coming to you because they know that you're not going to send them away. They know that you're not going to just kick them out the door and just. Amen. I want that for my children. And I don't know of any parent that doesn't. Mm-hmm. I don't know of any parent that doesn't. That's right. And so, saints, the little things that we neglect become bigger things. If we keep sweeping things under the rug because we think in our mind that it's not important, you're going to realize one day that you've made a mountain out of something that you could have stopped. There's a nursery rhyme that I found, and you've all may have heard it. If the brothers can ring it up. For want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. For want of a horse, the rider was lost. For want of a rider, the message was lost. For want of a message, the battle was lost.
For want of a battle, the kingdom was lost. And oh, for the want of a horseshoe nail.
Just let that sink in. All because you failed to fix the little things that came up in your life. Oh, it's not important? It's okay. Time will heal things. No, time doesn't heal things. If we keep that mentality up, we're not going to get anywhere. People are hurting. People need closure. And yet we still keep that mentality in our hearts. That's going to be the downfall of your family. It's going to be the downfall of this church. It's going to be the downfall of anybody that keeps that mentality in their heart.
So David's inconsistent life, amen. And Absalom, he experienced his dad's neglect. While everybody was praising him, and everybody was saying, oh, how great David was. He killed his mighty man, all these great things. Look at the great big cities that he built, and all these wonderful things that he said about, that people were saying about David, and yet they didn't know what was going on behind David's family life.
And Absalom saw this whole time, watching his dad. My dad doesn't want to play ball with me. Okay. Next day comes. Dad, can we sit down and pray? Son, you go ahead. Go ahead and pray on your own. I'll do it with you tomorrow. I'll read you that story tomorrow. Okay. 10 years later. Dad, can you come? Let's do this together. Let's go hunting together. Son, I've got this war I got to fight. I got this battle I can't do it today. Okay. Dad, can we go do this, that, or the other? I see that you're not doing anything. You're just up on the roof. What are you doing up on the roof? Looking at what? Not knowing at that moment David was sinning. What are you doing? And all this Absalom had in his heart, in his mind. And probably all his other children too. I'm challenging you, parents. Life, it can get in the way, but there's something we can stop it right now. You don't have to go that. You are responsible for your children until a certain point.
Amen.
At that point, amen, then you just give them over to God.
Right.
But we're their Holy Ghost up to a certain point.
Right.
I like one thing that Brother Joe told me one time. He said, I am not going to fail. I'm not going to fail to do the things and do things that with my children that will benefit them. Amen. And one day they go and tell me, Dad, you didn't do nothing with me. You didn't do this. Amen. That stayed with me. As we criticize, amen, because we're out too much doing things for the young people and camps and things like that. You know what, saints? You do not know that a seed can be planted at that particular camp that will give them the new birth at some point in time. The Word of God is being preached. Oh, the people probably saying, oh, Absalom, you're so lucky you have your dad as the king. And so lucky that your dad, and Absalom's probably, you know what? Yeah, but you just don't know. My dad may be your king, but he's not my dad. Remember what we're talking about, the neglected thirst.
Right.
So, and I don't know, saints, if you all have gone through experiences of maybe finding that your parents living double lives and things like that. I thank God I never had to go through something like that. But you know what? Absalom had to go through that. He found out that his dad was living a double life, committing adultery with Bathsheba. What do you think? How do you think he felt? What do you think went through his mind? You see? And saints, there is nothing that's going to persuade your children more than the life that you lived before them. If what comes out of your mouth is what you do, that is going to persuade them more than any money that you can give them. Here you go. Here's some money. You go on ahead now. It's okay. Here's some candy. That's gonna persuade them more than anything. Here's some food. Here's some food, son. Hey, here, go. You know, it's gonna cause more reaction from them to be want to be. I want what mom and dad have, than just patching kind of things up. And here you go. Here's the tablet. Here's the iPhone. Are you even thinking that you might be doing damage to your children by doing those things? Does that even go through your head that you might be doing that? And then when your children are out in the world and come home with things you never thought they would come home with, then you wonder if it was my fault. Because we see it, saints. Children that grew up in church. I'm not going to say here and say guarantee that my children won't go and do things that they're not supposed to do. I'll be the first one to say that. But I sure am going to do everything I can to cause it to right now, to cause to make sure they don't go those ways. And to sow something in their heart, amen, that will make them think on their ways when they're getting ready to do something they're not supposed to do. But sometimes what we do is just give them a phone. Or give them a tablet. We go do our own thing. I like it that it's quiet. Because you're listening to me. And I hope that you're thinking on your ways. Amen. When a child sees that they're serving and giving and forgiveness and reconciling and worshiping in the home and hospitality, amen, they're going to pick up those things. And they're going to learn and grow up. Amen. With those things. But when a child sees fighting, cheating, lying, no self-control, hypocrisy, jealousy, that's what do you think your child is going to learn? It's the simple law of reaping what you sow. Don't get upset at your child because he's acting just like you. So later on, when we see that Absalom, he was mentioned in 2 Samuel chapter 3. And then he's not mentioned again until 2 Samuel chapter 13. And it was in that story where Amnon, David's oldest son, raped his half-sister. As horrible as that looks and as horrible as it is, it's written in the Bible. It's in the Bible. That's the reason why I started off with the scripture that all scripture is given to us for examples, for correction, for us to look at and learn from. So here is Amnon. I'm not going to go through all the details of that. You can read it in 2 Samuel chapter 13. But at the end, amen, I want to read this. If the brothers could pull up 2 Samuel 13. Verses 19 through 22. Tamar is David's daughter. And Tamar put ashes on her head after the incident had happened, after Amnon had raped her, her own half-brother, and rent her garment of divers colors that was on her, and laid her hand on her head, and went on crying. And Absalom, her brother, said unto her, Hath Amnon thy brother been with thee? But hold now thy peace, my sister. He is thy brother. Regard not this thing. In other words, let's keep peace about this just for a little bit. So Tamar remained desolate in her brother Absalom's house. In other words, she was a wretched woman in Absalom's house because her virtue had been taken away by her own family member. But when King David heard all these things, he was very wroth. In other words, he was very angry. In other versions of the Bible says that he was very angry but did not punish Amnon. We don't see anywhere in the Bible where he punishes Amnon for what he did. That's a terrible sin, don't you think? It's horrible. But David, being the king, who had power to say and to decree and things as such, does not do anything about it. So guess what happens? Absalom starts building a complex and starts building a hate towards his father. First of all, to Amnon, his brother, because of his of what he did to his sister. And then towards his dad, because his dad didn't do anything about it. Now, I want us to look at our family life, saints. Are we correcting our children? Are we telling them, hey, you're wrong? You're wrong for doing that. Or are we just kind of just sweeping it under the rug? Just because they're our own children. And we don't want the public to see, and we don't want the church to know that our children did such and such. Do you know what happens when you do that? And you lie and you try to cover up things in your life and stuff like that? You're losing, you're damaging your own integrity. You're damaging your own integrity. If the ministry does that in the church, we're damaging our integrity here. If you as a family man, as a husband, as a wife, if you do that covering up for your children and things like that, and not acknowledging that you are wrong and you did it and try to make things right, then you're losing. Integrity goes a long way. Now nobody can trust you anymore. David got to this point with his children in Absalom's eyes. Because in those days, if you raped a woman and you were supposed to provide for her. You see? Or else you were going to get killed. So what was the reason why David didn't punish his own son, whether in private or in public? Maybe he was thinking about that Amnon was his firstborn, so he was next in line to be a king. And he didn't want to do anything to damage that dynasty that he was trying to build. Maybe that was the purpose. I don't know. But was it right? Was it right that his sister, that his own daughter was violated by his own son and nothing was said about it? Oh, I got mad about it. That's not doing anything about it. That's not going in and pulling out the scabs and going into that cancerous area and cleaning that infection. That does nothing. Going down deep into the root of the matter. Why? Because I don't have time. I don't have time to deal with it. I don't want conflict. I don't want to. Why are we so neglectful? Amen. As leaders of our home, as parents, as leaders of the church, we need to tell the truth, whether it hurts you or not. God knows if you didn't or not. God one day will be the one to. And your children are watching and listening. Whatever goes around comes around. And some of us have probably already experienced those things. I have. Sometimes my daughters may be acting a certain way or did something or doing something. I'm like, window, where did they get that from? Oh. They saw me doing that just a few years ago. I allowed that in my home. I allowed that music in my home. I allowed that thing in my home. Now you can't get mad at them. Now you have to go in and fix the thing at the root level and tell them why. Listen, sweetheart, listen, baby, we don't allow this in our home This is the reason why. I know that you saw me doing it. I know that you saw this, that, or the other. I'm sorry, and I should not have done it. We don't allow it in our home for this, this, this reason. Be willing to get down and humble yourself and say, I'm sorry. But as parents, we don't want to do that. We're too proud. The moment that you start covering up and telling lies, your integrity goes down the toilet. Amen. So David didn't do anything in order to preserve his kingdom. But that choice was what started the process of destroying what he wanted to preserve. So we keep going, and if the brothers could bring up how to raise a delinquent. I found this online. How to raise a delinquent. Now remember, Brother Branham said that it's not child delinquency, it's parent delinquency. He said that a lot of times. Begin in infancy to give your child whatever he or she wants. Then they will believe the world owes them a living. Step one. Step two, when they pick up vulgar words, laugh at them. This will make them think they are cute. Step three, how to raise a delinquent. Never give your child spiritual training. Wait until they are 21, then let them decide for themselves. Step four, we're getting there. We'll have a full-fledged delinquent here in just any moment now. Avoid the use of the words wrong or sin. These words may cause them to develop a guilt complex. This will condition your child to believe later, when he or she is arrested, that society is against them and they are being persecuted. Step five, we almost got him. Defend your child against neighbors, teachers, police officer, or any authority, and bail them out of any problem they get into with the law. They're all against your child, you know. And that's how you build, how you raise a delinquent. Ask yourself, is that what I'm doing? So we see that David here, he was an absent father. He led an inconsistent life, right? He was a neglectful disciplinarian. He didn't discipline it when he needed to. And finally, he caused an incomplete reconciliation. In other words, he just brushed it under the rug. And said, and Absalom is here, a boiling cauldron of bitterness, and he's not seeing none of that in his son. And so what happens is in 2 Samuel chapter 13, verse 22, and Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad. In other words, from that day forward, he didn't want to speak to his brother anymore. Right. David should have caught on that. Now, I believe if David would have done something about what Amnon did, it wouldn't have led Absalom to come to this point. For Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar. So guess what happens? Absalom takes matters into his own hands. So he has Amnon killed, and then flees. And we read in the Bible that David is crying for his son Amnon, rightly so. He's crying for his son Amnon, but then he gets over Amnon and he's crying for his son Absalom, because his son Absalom is gone from his presence for 3 years. Doesn't know anything about him. And all because of a choice that he made, that David made. Amen. But Absalom fled and went to Talmai, the son of Ammiud, king of Geshur, and David mourned for his son every day.
So Absalom fled and went to Geshur and went there 3 years. And the soul of King David longed to go forth unto Absalom, for he was comforted concerning Amnon, seeing he was dead. David longed to see his son Absalom. Amen. Because you see, saints, David was the one responsible, amen, to start that reconciliation process. He was the king. He was the father. He was the one who to initiate that process, but he didn't do anything about it. And we as the parents, amen, we're the ones who need, if we're the ones that have been given authority, we're the ones that have been given more maturity than our children, amen. We're the ones who are responsible, amen, to start that process of reconciliation. If your son and daughter did something, or if somebody did something to you, amen, you be the mature one to go start that reconciliation process. Right. Oh no, I'm going to wait till they come to me. That's not what the Bible says. No. Jesus said himself, if you have aught against somebody, amen, go make that right. But if you also know that there's aught in that person's heart towards you, you go in to that person. Isn't that what the Bible says? Then why do we sit around waiting? And our church is dying. And things are happening. And we're wondering what in the world is going on. In our family's life, in our social life, in the church, everything. And you could be the root cause. I heard Brother Branham tell a story the other day. He had a little boy come to him on a prayer line. He was demon possessed. And the boy was telling him, was calling brother, saying, Brother Branham, William Branham, you have nothing against me. It was the demons talking through him. And Brother Branham said, come to find out what it was something that his dad had done. That was the reason why that boy was like that. So sometimes it's not just your children's fault. Your children are looking at you and building complexes in their life and looking and say, oh, okay, mom has this or dad has this. Oh, okay. Well, this is what I'm going to do. And then you blame them for their actions and you blame them for their misbehavior when you were the one guilty of it. Ooh, that sounds hard, but it's the truth.
Right.
You're the one that has to begin the process of fixing problems, whether it's in the family or whether it's in church. You're the one. You're the leader. You're the one has to initiate those things. Why wait till people come to you? You go to them. So we can get that cancer out of the church. So we can get that root out of the family. Get that out of the way so that we can move on and go with God and grow. But you think we can grow when we have things still unresolved? Closure not being given about things that have happened. We can't move on with God.
And that rug just keeps getting higher and higher.
Even if you think that you're going to be rejected, go to the person anyhow. Make that right, because it's a thing between you and God. It's your relationship between you and God. We're not going to heaven with bitterness in our heart. I'm going to tell you that right now. We're not going in glory with things unresolved amongst us. And things, people are still holding things from years that have happened. And nothing is said. It's just swept under the rug. And time proves that time doesn't heal. Time has not healed those things. Because they still keep coming up. Amen. So we read later on in 2 Samuel where David, he's convinced that he should have Absalom back in Jerusalem. Absalom comes back in Jerusalem. 3 years that he's been away from his father, that bitterness still building and bubbling in him and that cancerous thing. And so he has Absalom back, but we don't read anywhere in 2 Samuel where he has Absalom back and David gets down talking business with him. We don't.
Oh, Absalom is back in Jerusalem. Great. But David doesn't go and initialize, son, we need to talk. Son, I'm so sorry. Son, I did this. What's wrong, son? No, none of that. We don't read none of that in the Bible. What happens is that when Absalom comes to David, you know what happens? All David does is give him a kiss. In 2 Samuel 14:33, so Joab came to the king and told him, and when he had called for Absalom, he came to the king and bowed himself on his face to the ground before the king, and the king kissed Absalom. And that's all. See, in David's eyes, he wanted a quick fix. A kiss, a pat in the back. You go on, brother. Everything will be fine. And Absalom's still hurting for what happened to his sister and David's lack of rebuking what needed to be rebuked. It was just superficial reconciliation. Amen. No talk about mending their pasts. No talk about going in and cleaning out the wound. No talk about I'm wrong. No, none of that. I'll just give you a silly kiss or a pat on the back or a hug. We don't like that. I don't know why. I grew up, amen, talking about things and resolving things right away. Why do we don't do that? Problems come up. Take care of them right away. Before they fester, before they grow. Am I wrong? Amen. You know, what if your spouse, amen, has been cheating on you and sleeping with other men or other women or whatever, and they get caught, and they just come and they just come and say, well, don't worry about it. Let's just move on. Come on, let's just don't worry about it. Let's just move on. What do you think that wife or that husband would think about that? How should they react towards that? And yet that's what we do with our children. That's what we do in the church. That's what we do with all these issues that come up. We just sweep them off. And don't get to the root of the problem. Don't get to the heart of the issue. Because it's just too much work. You know, saints, I'd rather have truth. I'd rather have truth. Amen. I'd rather be out there pulling the weeds and taking everything out that needs to be got. And what's left, if you do that, is truth. But we don't like that. We like easy, quick fix, microwave solutions. Because we don't want to go through the pain of deep healing. The consequences of David's silence towards Amnon's sin against Tamar caused Absalom to grow roots of bitterness. Amen. So Absalom, this whole time was resentful. He was revengeful. He was constantly reminded of the situation. In one place in the scripture where it says that he gave birth to he had some kids. One of the children's name was Tamar. One of his daughter's name was Tamar. He named them after his own sister. He was reminded of what happened. And then we overreact. See, we got this bitterness in us. We have this bitterness and this hate and this things that are unresolved in us, and we start acting in unseemly ways. You know, sometimes when maybe our wife or maybe our husband or our children, they're acting in a certain way and they're giving you this certain attitude. And the first thing you want to do is launch at, why are you acting like that? What in the world? What's wrong with you? But if you step back and say, what is causing that in them? So maybe something is bothering them that's causing them to act like that. And you step back and you see, what is it, son? What is it, daughter? What is it? What's going on? Let's talk. And then you find out that it wasn't the superficial reason. It wasn't for a superficial reason. It was something deeper than that. But because you find out if you take time. When you don't take time and you want easy microwave quick fix solutions, then you won't find out what the root of the problems are. So this rebellion and all these things, this hatred was in Absalom's heart. And in one place, he sets Joab's field on fire. Joab being one of David's captains or helpers. I can't remember exactly what he was. And he because he's building all this hate and all this stuff like that, he goes and sets Joab's field on fire. And then in another verse, you'll find that Absalom was up there in the roof sleeping with David's concubines. Just trying to take it, all that hate and all that bitterness, taking it out on other people and all that are not at fault whatsoever. Why? Again, because it wasn't resolved from the beginning. It's just growing bigger and bigger. We think that time is going to heal it. No, and not in this case. Now, who are we, amen, to be different than what happened to Absalom? Or what happened to David? All because David failed to act at a very crucial time. Instead of sweeping it under the rug. 2 Samuel 14:14. You know what, saints? I like what this verse says. It says, "For we must needs die, and are as water spilt on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. Neither doth God respect any person, yet doth he devise means that his banished be not expelled from him." This is the person that came to David to convince him to let Absalom come back to Jerusalem. And this is what he told him. He said, even God tries to do what he can to restore and to have relationship with that person. Amen. We read in Isaiah chapter 1, if the brothers could read a very familiar verse to us. Isaiah chapter 1. God is concerned. God wants your relationship with... I've always heard this. If your horizontal relationships are right, then your vertical relationships will be right. Let me say that again. If your horizontal relationship is right, your vertical relationships will be right. The one with God. But if your horizontal relationships are down the toilet, how in the world are you going to say that you have a relationship with God? You can't. Wash. This is God speaking through Isaiah. Wash you, make you clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Seek righteous judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Come now and let us reason together. I don't see it where God says, come and let's just sweep it under the rug and let's move on. Come and let us reason together. Saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. God is already willing. Well, he's ready to forgive. But you need to come to him. You need to make that thing right. Be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, like Absalom, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. God is ready. He's a merciful God. He's more merciful and more gracious than you think. Why would he not want to restore that relationship with you when you've done everything you can to restore the relationship with others? God's not going to hear your prayer if you've got bitterness in your heart. God will not hear your prayer if you have not made things right with the people that you know that you hurt or that you lied to. See, because what and we're about to close. Religion is what man does to try to get close to God. See, that's what religion is. It's what I can do to appease God. But Christianity is what God has done, amen, to get closer to you. And see, God is the one that advocates talking about things, restoration, going up and pulling out roots of bitterness and going down to the root matter of the issues. He's the one that initiates that. Then why don't we do it? And we're supposed to have the love of God. Why don't we do it? What's the problem? I'm going to finish with this, saints. If the brothers could bring this up. And you know, saints, later on we see that Absalom, he rebels against his own father. Tries to dethrone him and take over the kingdom. And then you know the story. And then Absalom gets killed by his own device. Absalom dies. All because David failed to do something at the beginning. Absalom dies, and Absalom and David, amen, almost loses his kingdom, causes more problems in his family and in bitterness and all kinds of things, all because he failed at the beginning to correct something he should have corrected, no matter what the people would have said. And this is where I got this title, amen, A Neglected Thirst. Brother Branham says, I want you to see another great danger. Just before we close, if you're not guilty of any of these things that I've mentioned, and that is the danger of neglecting a thirst. See, you say, I have a holy thirst, but I'm not guilty, Brother Branham, or just go on joining church and things like this. But see, to neglect a thirst, if you neglect to satisfy a thirst of water or food, you will die. All right? And if you neglect that thirst in you for God, you will spiritually die. All right? You call for revivals. You wait for your church to have a revival. Well, that ain't the revival for you. The revival ought to begin right in you. All right? Take these things and apply them to what we've been talking about. When you begin to thirst for God, there might be another member of the church wanting that revival. It breaks out in you. It will break out other places, see? But see, you neglect that thirst. You neglect to do what you're supposed to do. You neglect to milk the cow when the udder is full of milk. And if you let that cow stay like that, she'll go dry. That's exactly right. If you neglect to take a drink of water, say, I just ain't got to drink anymore, you'll die. You neglect to eat food, you'll die. So if you neglect to give the Holy Spirit the Word of God, you'll die. Because the Holy Spirit can't feed on nothing but the Word. Amen? Maybe this is what you wanted to hear tonight. But maybe somebody will take it and it might change their lives. I'm tired of not dealing with things at the root level. I'm tired of just living life and just sweeping things under the rug. Why? Why? Stand to our feet. Lord Jesus, as we come before you, Father God, we thank you, Lord, once again for your mercy and your grace and your love. Thank you, Lord, because, Father God, we see these things, we see these examples in the Bible. We see, Father God, the hurt and the pain and the suffering, Father God, because of a failure, Father God, of someone, Father, to do something that they needed to do, Father, neglecting, Father, a neglected thirst, Lord. Father God, you forgive us, Lord, this hour, Lord. You cleanse us, Lord Jesus, Father God, because that's not what we want, Lord, and that's not what we desire, Lord. Father God, there's people hurting, Lord, and Father God, things unresolved, Lord Jesus, Father. But Lord God, you know, Father God, that you can make all wrongs right, Lord Jesus. And Father God, we humble ourselves to you, Lord Jesus. And Father God, we just give ourselves to you, Lord. You have your will and your way, Lord. I had to preach what was on my heart, Father God. And so, Lord Jesus, you just do, Father God, with your word, Lord, as you see fit, Lord. Take it, Father God, and let it be rooted, Father God, in the heart that needs to receive it, Lord Jesus. And change us, Father God, as Brother Branham said in that prayer earlier, Lord. Change us from the inside out, Lord. Let us, Father God, be willing, Lord God, to hit, Father God, where things need to be hit, Lord. For the ultimate goal, Lord God, and that's to us to be right, Lord God Almighty. Help us, O Lord. Father God, it's not easy, Lord. But Father God, it's the best thing in the long run, Lord Jesus. You forgive me, Father, if I've said something that I shouldn't have said, Lord. I don't want any bad attitudes. I don't want anything, Lord God. And Father God, I just plead the blood right now for each one of us here, Lord. And Lord, ask, Father God, that you reveal to us, Lord God, if there's something that is hindering, Father God, our walk with God and the progress of this church, Lord, and the progress of our home spiritually, Lord God, then reveal it to us and show it to us and help us to be humble enough, Father God, to make things right, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus, I pray, oh God, we love you. We ask that you'd be with the people now as they go home, and we commit ourselves into your hands now. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Sing something, Brother Boyd. I don't know what you have. Praise the Lord.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God.
If you have a need of prayer, more than welcome to pray. Restore unto me the joy.
joy of thy salvation and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew
prayer.
Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy spears and soul. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not my Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and renew a right. Create in me a clean heart, O God.
Think about this.
Renew a right spirit within. Cast me not away from thy presence. and renew a right spirit within me.
Amen, saints. You know, David prayed those words in the psalm there after Nathan came and told him that he was the man that caused, you know, all that committed the sin there, caused a lot of pain and a lot of suffering there. But you know what, saints, he still had to face the consequences of those things. Even though he was repentant in his heart and so be prepared to face consequences. If you're engaged in constant wrong and you don't make things right, then prepare for the consequences. But there's grace there. There's mercy there. Christ is full of it. Christ wants to give you that peace in your heart that you desire. But you're still gonna face consequences, ramifications of your actions. Because remember, we reap what we sow.
Right.
Amen. Amen. I don't know. But wait, is there anything? Saturday, remember the at 1 o'clock the fall festival. So remember that. Amen. So if all hearts and minds are clear. Amen. May God bless you as we sing. As we sing this, you may be dismissed.
You lead me. You guide me. You dwell.